If you actually think I was just the right guy at the right place at the right time, let me say it one more time so you completely understand, McMahon. If you actually believe in your mind, if you actually think that I was just the right guy at the right place at the right time, well, then you're a bigger delusional bastard than I thought you were, McMahon.
Hey everybody, and welcome back to episode 51 of the Dark Match. As usual, I am No Leaf Clover.
Oh, hello, I'm Christopher Says, Dark Match's Mastodon of the Monotone.
Hello, I'm your token chick duo's Angel.
And as always, I am your foxy friend Backlash. And for those of you who don't like giving us money watching our videos on Blip TV, we now have a YouTube page. Yay!
Yay! We're broke!
Woohoo!
But hey, they approved us for videos longer than 15 minutes. And then they bounced most of our videos back. Sorry to our German fans. But it's now time for what's quickly becoming our favorite segment, What is the Ultimate Warrior Tweeting? And this was apparently in reply to someone called Sandbagger39 on Twitter, who was asking Ultimate Warrior the question, why do you hate fat people, and why did your mom not teach you two wrongs don't make a right? And this was Ultimate Warrior's response.
Oh, no.
Don't hate fat people! I don't hate NH! As I said, I hate the fat people, hate themselves so much, they choose to be fat!
What? Well, you got me there. But to be fair, yes, I don't work in my health. I do kind of choose to be fat, so, hey. And by the way, I'm Sandbagger69.
Well, moving on from that insanity to a different insanity, Impact Wrestling, everyone.
Hey.
I can tell we're all really excited to talk about this show.
We get Main Immortal Mafia. Main Immortal. Oh God, tongue twister. We get
here. We know it's recapping the whole thing about Anderson joining Immortal, and nobody gives a shit. We didn't give a shit when it happened. We didn't give a shit when it was being built up. We don't give a shit now that it has happened. And we don't give a shit now that they're screwing it up even more.
Mm. Oh, and by the way, TNA, you use and abuse the guy wins and people carry him on their shoulders. It worked much better for Brian Kendrick than Anderson, sadly.
It did?
Yeah, it did. That was a feel-good moment.
Yeah, that's the kind of thing.
Well, for those of you who don't see Hendrick, not much, but would you prefer the X-rated Abyss? I'll think that Victor's getting rid of X-rated Abyss. Oh, and No Leaf is already broken.
But the reason why I attempted to make that tongue twister is because Immortal comes out in their own suits, and it's funny because, like, one of the first people you see is Bubba, and the first thought you have is, wow, that you never don't see that every day, and two is, wow, he looks pretty good. Oh, he's wearing that chain.
And of course, the highlight of people in tuxes is Abyss. Apparently, I think he got into a pie-eating contest before he came to the ring.
Not so much that is...
That is the impression I got.
That's his kind of carryover from Mick Foley, that when Mick Foley wears a suit, it has to look disheveled and, like, ugh, I don't know.
I would well, like Abyss is a ripoff of anyone who ever wore a mask in WWE.
How can you be Kane and Mick Foley and Sabu and Terry Funk and fucking everybody all at the same time? Does Abyss have schizophrenia?
Not literally at the same time. You do one person one week, you do another the next. Just, you know, you kind of bounce around.
Right, my fault.
There's one thing I would like to comment on. I've actually brought this up before because I thought it was just a one-time thing, but I hadn't noticed, but apparently it is a thing for Bully Ray to stop midway down the ramp, look at the camera, and start shouting at the camera. You can't hear him over any entrance music. The camera doesn't stay on him. They'll switch to the camera next to the ring at the end of the ramp. So whatever shot they're doing with him up on the ramp, you see maybe two cuts of it.
Yeah, I
don't understand what the fuck that's supposed to be.
Yeah, I was listening to that show where you said that on and laughing about it. And then I watched this and I was like, oh, that's a
thing. I didn't know he kept doing it.
They did that on purpose.
I don't know.
Because in the show, I was like, maybe that was an accident. Maybe they just forgot to cut. No, they're doing that on purpose.
Like, I would assume that what he's doing is that it's supposed to be like, you know, I'm tough and I'm going to be, like, all intimidating. You can't hear anything he's saying. They don't stay on him for very long. You know, they'll cut back, but it's, like, for a couple of seconds. And especially with this, with them all coming down as a group, it just looks stupid.
Yeah. Anyways, we get into the ring, and Eric Bischoff, who is insanely drunk, gets on the mic and says that they're there to welcome... Yeah, he was drunk off his ass, anyone can tell. They're there to welcome Ken Anderson into the Immortal Family.
They have a gambling table, poker table, and like the right, which and, pretty much foreshadows all the metaphors that they're going to make.
And is it just me, or... Was the poker table there kind of just a jab at Raw Roulette? Because Raw did that a couple weeks ago where they did Raw Roulette. They say, hey, let's do our own gambling theme.
Well,
I have to picture someone in TNA said that.
I want to think that, but at the same time, I don't really care. I don't think it's too big of a deal.
It might honestly have been just to set up jokes and... set up dialogue from somebody that we'll be getting to here soon.
Yeah.
Ah, yes.
God damn it.
So Bischoff stumbles over his lines drunkenly for a bit. Then Hogan gets on the mic and very shakily talks about Anderson for 5 seconds because he's high off his ass, too. And then they bring out Anderson in a fucking camouflage tuxedo.
Just when I think
I can't hate this douchebag anymore, he manages to just add that little something that makes me want to punch him in the face.
Can I be devil's advocate and say that he's an effective heel for wearing that grimy tuxedo?
Grimy? It was fucking tacky. Revolverman has it here in the chat. It looked like somebody splashed, like he was wearing just some weird olive suit, and somebody started flicking lines of white paint across it.
So it's basically like a Pollock suit?
Yeah, except stupider.
No, to top us all
the first time I saw it.
You think that's bad?
Like,
no, it's worse than that.
But yeah, to top it all,
like came from a pie-eating contest. Anderson looked like he just walked out of a paintball tournament set during the 90s.
You think that's bad? Wait, you think that's bad? Try having to explain why the fucking white guy with the belt is wearing a camouflage tuxedo to your girlfriend. It's not easy.
See, that's why I don't want to impact
leave it at that.
Yeah,
but yeah,
was not.
I get nervous, she'll stop giving me sex if I do that. God, she's not watching this.
But, like, the, to top all this
oh,
off,
is
like...
Is Mike still on?
That was Awkward Moments with Backlash. Back to our regularly scheduled program.
Alright, anyways...
further awkward moments.
Yeah, he continues to make me want to punch him in the face. Basically, they're just... they're just telling Anderson, like, oh, you've had a rocky road here in TNA ever since you got here, but now you're part of the family. What the fuck does that even mean?
I think it's a fucking mob reference. You're part of the family.
And
of course, they have... No, go ahead.
I'd say the probably the worst part of this is that he gets in the ring, and the first thing Hogan says is, love the look, brother. He's in our face even more.
I wouldn't expect a man who starred in Thunder in Paradise to have good taste.
I thought that was supposed to be good.
It's so bad it's good. And even, and I'm being generous, because I really like crappy-ass TV shows.
Well, anyways, let me pull back up the results. Of course, they have a gambling table set up, so Anderson has to reference gambling, saying, oh, it was a gamble to join Immortal. No, it's not a gamble. It basically ensures that... Well, actually, no, that's not true, because Immortal has been looking pathetic as of late.
Well, but also, like, it wasn't much of a gamble.
Later in the night.
It wasn't... I mean, for Anderson, it wasn't much of a gamble. Like, as Tifa said last week... The way they presented, like, the offering of, like, joining them was much more enticing than the way Kurt Angle and Sting did it. By basically threatening him.
Yeah, am I going to join the team that welcomes me with open arms? Or am I going to join the team that threatens to kick my ass if I don't join their team?
Well, you know, if there was any continuity... It would actually be the option between the guys that screwed me time and time and time and time and time and time again, or these other assholes that have threatened me. But, well, it's TNA continuity. Obviously, nothing that has happened before the offer exists.
Nothing that happens ever matters in this company.
Well, I guess the asshole only cares for his own asshole and not the other asshole's assholes. And I've increased the quota and... outdone you, Anderson. So, speaking of threatening to beat him up, the next person that the screen darkens and Sting's in the ring with all of them, and of course there's so many people in there and just one Sting, and they don't do anything. They just stand there and like, we gotta hear what he has to say.
He teleported into the ring. Should we beat him up? No. We're not trying to be rude here. Why would we just attack the guy when we have a numbers advantage?
Well, there is sort of like this weird thing in wrestling where, yeah, you kind of hear them out and then you kick their ass.
Yeah.
I don't know, but Sting basically just goes on and says that he's on a crusade to bring Dixie Carter back to her rightful place in TNA. And I really don't know how to feel about that because, well, Dixie Carter, but then on the other hand, Hogan.
Okay, storyline-wise, this is a good
thing. Storyline-wise, probably.
Especially since we know that no matter what, Dixie's in charge anyways.
But do we really want her on TV every week again?
No, we don't want her on TV every week.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's kind of like... If she comes back...
I mean, Hogan and Bischoff, they aren't going away. This is something we're going to have to accept eventually.
Mm. Well, Sting pretty much... And, like, I don't like the incongruency with last year where Sting was basically threatening Dixie and telling her that he owes her nothing and that it's her fault that, like, these guys are going to take over. And now he's just like, yeah, I pity you. I'm going to bring you back.
He choked the woman half to death last year.
Yeah.
Nothing that happened last year matters.
Nothing that happened last week matters.
No, but see, but this was all in an effort to warn her about Immortal. So it is kind of relevant, in my opinion.
we've beat that dead horse into the ground.
Okay,
that
okay.
The easiest way to tell her about Immortal was to say, Immortal is coming!
Wow, was that a little
logic?
Was that a little bit of Lars coming through?
Oh, shit.
he's your hide.
Hang on, I need to get a glass of water. I'll be right back.
But yeah, Sting definitely makes with the gambling references and in a very overwrought Family Guy-esque way. Like he's like, oh, I've got a bunch of aces. Like he picks up a card. Here's one, and here's another, 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 and here's another. I don't like that.
There's only four aces in a deck, right?
He his Sting overrules that rule.
Apparently.
Okay, I'm back. So what are we up to now?
Same segment, which really we should probably move along.
Yeah, he goes on to show them what those aces are, points the rafters to reveal a 3-year-old Dark Knight Joker henchman, which that's just what they are.
Yeah, it's the exact same mask.
Well, not exact same
mask. I rewatched the Dark Knight, they're almost fucking identical.
Well, they're half masks. Whereas the ones in the film were full masks. That's the only difference, but...
More or less, exactly the same. You know when they were trying to get those masks, whoever's in charge of costume design says they have to look like the Dark Knight.
Oh, of course.
This is why we shouldn't let Vince Russo watch any more movies.
Ever again.
Anyways. Basically, Sting just flips over the poker table, lights go out again, and he vanishes. Mm-hmm. End of segment, moving on. Wrestling time. Triple Threat, Bound for Glory series. Pope, Samojo, and Robert Roode. All the guys who have no points yet, so someone's leaving this getting points.
Yeah. That's it. And plus, like, they add in, like, the Joe-esque, psychology-esque shit where he has to get one win and he's in the gutter because I don't even know what his psychological state is supposed to be.
His psychological standpoint is, I have to get as many points as I can, so he's not going for pinfalls ever. He's just doing all submission moves.
Uh-huh. Oh, yeah. Oh, he's putting eggs in one basket. Yeah, but nonetheless, this was a good show. Like, I thought it was a... Like, there's highlights, like, Pope doing a pretty smooth STO. Like, he had a lot of good offense. Rude did a really nice fisherman suplex.
There were good spots in this match, but again, Joe just has the air of I don't give a shit anymore.
I mean, as far as recent Joe matches go, I thought this was one of the better ones, but maybe that was because there were two other guys, you know, kind of covering his ass.
Yeah.
You have a point. But nonetheless, I believe, Joe, the finish is pretty much when Joe has a choke on Rude but Rude like kicks off for one of the corners and he basically turns into a pin to get his first 7 points.
But what happens is right after the referee counts the pinfall, Rude taps out to the rear naked choke, and Joe, well, he thinks he won and he starts arguing with Earl Hebner,
who fucking argues back like very vehemently too.
Hebner has never taken shit from anyone, not even someone Joe's size.
Yeah, he screws people for his own cause. But motherfuck, this Joe you're arguing with. I guess they're trying to put over more that Joe has fallen by the wayside. Even Earl Hebner could fucking stand up to you.
I mean, as far as this storyline goes, I don't like it, but at least it's consistent. You know? At least Joe has...
Well, I don't like it, but...
Yeah, at least he has one storyline, and they're sticking with it, and they're making it appear that he's trying to do something. He's not just floating around doing fucking nothing, you know, except losing.
Yeah, but see, the problem with, I mean, a lot of people complain about wrestling angles because they're too on the nose or they're too obvious. This one is way too vague, in my opinion. Like, it's like, we see what you guys are trying to do, but you gotta, like, come out with it. You gotta, like... Like, you can't just have Kazarian going like, what's up with you, man? What's up with you? Fuck you, I'm gonna beat you up. Like, he has to cut a promo, like a clear promo, without any brawls, without any door frames, like an in-ring one.
Yeah. I would assume they're building up to something like that. They're just taking longer than they really should.
Or they're just leading us on, and this is going to be dropped a month before Bound for Glory. Because, you know, that's TNA's MO.
Yeah.
That is entirely possible.
Yeah, but speaking of the Bound for Glory series, it's worth mentioning that Crimson is still in first place with only 30 points. And there are still three-way ties for second, third, and fourth place.
Yeah, I think we pretty much established that this tournament is get Crimson over angle. Or get Crimson over.
And the sick thing is, I don't even think he's had a Bound for Glory series match on TV yet.
Yeah, that's, yeah.
No, I think
that. Yeah, he had one.
Okay, he had one, but he's got most of his points. He's in the lead. He's only gotten 7 points on TV. Everything else is done at house shows. Jesus Christ.
Well, I guess I'm going to have to go see the house shows then.
Oh, fuck. It's the time. Jeff and Karen Jarrett, and they're back with sombreros that they probably bought at the Universal Studios gift shop. The stipulation of Jeff Jarrett's match with Kurt Angle that he was exiled from the country. It was in his contract. He had to live in Mexico if he lost to Kurt Angle in that street fight.
Who cares? That was a stupid fucking stipulation to begin with. Like,
I guess someone in TNA went, you know what? I don't think we have the authority to do this.
Thinking about it, can wrestling companies exile people? No. It doesn't work like that. Does the United States even use exile?
It was
in jail.
It was a stupid storyline. But god damn it, if they ever had to follow a stupid storyline, this would be the one!
Yeah.
This is the one you're supposed to run with, TNA? God damn this company.
Alright, here are options. They could come back, or we could constantly get segments where they cut away to the Jarretts in Mexico.
Or a green screen.
Can't we just open a black hole and have it swallow them up?
Either way, we...
Portal working.
Yeah.
Okay, next up, it's Hulk and Eric. They're talking about how they're going to deal with Sting. And,
Bischoff says, I failed to take out the X Division. I'm not going to fail at this. Or something like that.
And then Jeff Jarrett comes in, and
What happened was, Abyss goes, don't worry, Eric, I got it. And Eric goes, really? You got it, Abyss? Because you kind of failed at that whole killing the X Division thing. Do you really have it? Which, you know, it's funny that he's the owner of the company and he wants an entire division killed off. Because, you know, that division doesn't make the money or isn't the most entertaining part of the show.
Yeah, or doesn't separate him and just distinguish them from WWE in any way.
No.
Put on one of the better pay-per-views of the year.
I know. I mean, clearly we're imagining all this shit.
Yeah, they're the heels thing.
Yeah. So anyways, Jarrett, he comes in to hand out sombreros to everyone in Immortal and reveal that he's brought a present back for Hulk Hogan. It is what he refers to as the Dos J Championship.
Ugh.
Get it? Double J in Spanish?
It's the Triple A heavyweight
title. Triple A belt. And I have never been a big follower of Triple A, but I do know their title, that in Mexico it is very prestigious. This thing is a complete bastardization.
Well,
why did you do this, Triple A? I understand you have a working agreement with TNA, but I don't think they watched the show. I think that's what it is. I don't think they
not only that, but I don't think he mentioned the promotion by name at all.
Nope.
At all.
No, he didn't call
so as far as TNA is concerned, Jeff Jarrett just randomly made this pointless belt. My God, this company is stupid. Keep lying.
Well, yeah, good point. But to basically, like, talk about this segment, this reminds me of the segments he had at Universal Studios with Karen Jarrett, where she was being the sort of the wet blanket, and he was kind of being the very fun-loving kind of goofy face. And same thing for me. It's in a completely different world than the rest of Immortal.
If he was just, you want to know the truth, if Jeff Jarrett was just a goofy face, I would have, like, a zillion less problems with him than I actually do right now.
Oh, yeah. You know, it would be kind of interesting to see him around, just kind of coming in and being, you know, just like a bright ray of sunshine no matter what. But no, he's Jeff Jarrett.
But we move from there to a backstage segment between Pope and D-Von. Some more absurdities coming out, but we're basically Pope is backstage with Terrence and Terrell, and they're talking about how they support him and he's still pimping despite not being as prominent. And D-Von interrupts just to tell him to stay away from him and tell Pope that he's like, what, I'm the one who tells him to say jump, and then they jump. Stuff like that. A lot of really kind of suspicious.
Don't care about this feud.
Yeah.
I just don't get it.
Like, I don't either.
Well, and also,
my only guess is that there's a talented Mr. Ripley angle going on here. That Pope is actually trying to take over Devon's life.
I don't think that.
And that would actually be kind of interesting to watch.
If you're the Pope and you want to take over someone's life, are you really going to pick D-Von?
Grass is always greener and that sort of thing.
Good point.
Really? You want... You,
two great sons. There you would want to take over.
You would want two hormonal teenage sons, a wife who nags you, you have to pay bills, you have to pay for the house, they probably have dogs.
Is the only member of the Dark Match with a girlfriend? Shut up.
Goddamn. Thanks for reminding me that I don't have a girlfriend, Duos.
Sorry.
No, it's just a chain.
What about Backlash?
But
wait, Noli, you have a girlfriend.
No, she was talking about, she was saying that to me, but you have a girlfriend too.
Oh. Yeah. Wait, what's happening? I'm confused.
I blame all three
space!
Of you. But either way, something that I found, like, particularly egregious, like, wall-banging about this promo is that Pope's, he's like, come on, man, I gave you a win. I gave you 7 points in the Bound for Glory series. I let you pin the guy, and D-Von was like, that was just a product of your own damn stupidity. Like, how do you just snub a gift like that? Like, I don't get, like, how irrational you could be, despite, like, this is definitely not the kind of things I give a pass for being, like, a wrestling angle.
So is the thing going to be that, like, D-Von doesn't trust Pope ever, and then Pope screws him? Because that's not going to make sense. What would make sense is if Pope is doing all this stuff, and then D-Von goes, you know what? Maybe Pope's not such a bad guy, you know? Maybe he's
And then
just...
Pope starts acting peelish.
Yeah, exactly. Instead of Pope's acting like a cool dude, and D-Von's coming off like a complete asshole. This is the problem in fucking TNA. And even when they don't fucking mean to do it, all the faces always end up looking like fucking dicks, and the fucking heels end up looking like cool guys.
At this point, I just put all my money on the fact that all storylines go absolutely nowhere. Because that's usually how it ends up.
But maybe that is
stuff like this will always just eventually be dropped and forgotten about.
Well, yeah.
Or it'll be taken care of on Explosion.
It started on Explosion. One would hope they'd just leave it there.
Yeah.
But yeah,
enough about D-Von. We move on to a video package from Destination X, and... And say what you want about Destination X, it makes a good goddamn video package.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, they made it. I mean, I like the pay-per-view and the highlight reel. Yeah, all those flips. Like.
And then we get the official debut. Oops, sorry.
No, go.
Okay, we get the official debut of Austin Aries in his first official TNA match against Shannon Moore. And am I the only one who didn't really like this match?
It was
nothing to write home about.
It was okay, but
it was okay.
It was like
it felt a little clumsy.
Yeah, if nothing else, it was only kind of to get Aries over as a heel, like. To sort of show like where he's going to be aligned, and which is kind of funny because I don't remember what Shannon Moore being a face in the past few months. Like I remember Jesse Neal being the face of that team.
They bounce him back and forth all the time, but
another thing that's really hard to explain to your girlfriend is what the fuck the Book of Dilly Gap is.
Again,
well, Shannon Moore has instructed us on that in the past. He has explained. Google it, woman! Anyone who remembers when he first joined the company?
Yeah, and they were pushing him as an X-Division contender, yeah. He actually was pretty decent in this match for the spots that they gave him, and, like, I mean, one of them being, like, countering Aries' skin the cat through the middle and top rope. But, but basically, yeah, it's to get him over as a heel. The finish is where he hits Shannon Moore with the chain of Dilly Gaff, and afterwards Alex Shelley comes in to confront him, which like the commentators didn't really like. Of all people, Alex Shelley. I mean, if nothing else, like the two were in Generation Next, but like in ROH, but of course they can't say that.
Anyways, like I said, I didn't really care for this match, mostly because it just looked kind of clumsy. I really think Shannon Moore's hair is throwing him off balance.
I would have much rather had Low Ki or Jack Evans get their contract. I don't see why Austin Aries is back.
I disagree. Like, well, then again, I wasn't watching TNA when he was around. Like, I'm not too used to him. Like, I welcome him. He seems like a good guy. He probably cut a better promo than Low Ki. I hate to say it, but like that deep voice is a little awkward. Either way, but yeah, Shelley, we have after that we have a backstage promo with Abyss.
Yeah, Abyss is backstage. Basically, that Kendrick has something that belongs to him, and he's going to take down the X Division once and for all. And then he gets jumped by one of the Joker clones.
Yeah.
Hit some of the baseball bats.
And Abyss sells it like death.
That was coming.
Yeah.
And that one guy, baseball shot to the rib obviously kills him for the rest of the night because we don't see Abyss again.
But yeah, as you could tell, listeners, we don't have much to say about this. Like, what's more to say beyond to continue to criticize the fact that it's a ripoff of The Dark Knight and an obvious one at that.
Anyways, next is a promo from Shannon Moore backstage with Alex Shelley, and Shelley talking about his title match with Kendrick next week, which, by the way, here's a spoiler, Abyss is interfering.
What? No.
Oh, come on. You don't see that coming a mile away?
Of course I do. Everyone should.
Surely you just, sir.
Oh, and actually, getting back to what I was saying, like, apparently Shelley and Aries, like I said, I wasn't watching TNA before 09, but, like, they had some kind of a stable thing going, but, like, I don't know if they spoke about that on this episode of Impact. Like, they didn't even put over, like, any kind of history between the two or whatever. Who the hell knows?
Why would they do that? Why would they fill us in on valuable backstory that we would like to know?
Yeah, why tell us things that actually make everything interesting and add depth to the characters? For wrestling.
That takes too much work. There's nobody at TNA that cares enough to do that.
Or has time.
No, they're too busy making up stupid nicknames for Abyss.
Anyways.
Up next is a video package between the Tara and Madison Rayne feud. And Tara got Madison a present because she just wants to be friends. I love Tara. I'll say that. I think she's a great wrestler and a great personality. I hate Madison Rayne. She is dragging down the entire Knockouts division.
Well, it's her and Velvet Sky and Angelina Love and...
Well, no, it's mostly just Madison Rayne because for the past, like, year, she's been the God Mode Sue of the fucking Knockouts division.
What?
And it's only... Well, how long was she Knockouts champion?
Well, true, but... But the way she lost it kind of...
She's been the primary focus, though. Even though she jobbed like a bitch on pay-per-view, she was right back...
She's getting more screen time than Mickie James.
Yes. Mickie's not even on this fucking episode of the show.
I mean, the way I remember it, they're focusing more on, like, Love and Winter over the past, like, couple of months. So, like, I definitely didn't have any complaints about her being oversaturated. Like, I kind of thought they went by the wayside with that.
Things a little odd, because it seems like they have, like... You know, the women's division does have several feuds going on, but you only ever see, like, one every so often. Like, I'm assuming they do one per taping or some shit. It seems like, you know, they focus on one for a while, and then they'll switch back. It's really weird.
Yeah.
Like, I even forgot that there was a Tara Rayne feud.
They don't have enough screen time for all of them, so...
They had the opportunity to ignite this feud months ago when they actually split up initially, but now they're doing it now for some reason. They do this a lot, and their match was as mediocre as you'd imagine, with Tara, like, doing most of the best work.
I don't think it was mediocre. I think it was okay for what it was.
I thought it was an okay match. It was...
Yeah.
I'm a bit disappointed that Madison is not very fluid in doing moves. Seems very slowed down compared to Tara.
I'm a bit disappointed that Madison isn't really busting out the I fall down anymore.
Well, that's because she's just not top of the card anymore.
Yeah, well, it's because she came up with a new... Like Duo said, it's because she came up with a new move. It's called I Stumble Around.
if nothing else, like, the contrast between, like, Madison hitting spots and Tara hitting spots, like, for instance, her fireman carry sidewalk slam, like, huge, huge contrast.
You can clearly tell who's the veteran and who is still... Even though she's been wrestling for, you know, 3 or 4 years now, Madison's still rather green.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The finish comes when, basically, Madison gets Tara down, and she goes over to the present that Tara brought out, and she opens it because she wants to find out. And inside is Tara's pet tarantula poison. Madison,
anyone's
God surprised. Bless her, has absolute greatest woman scared of spider reaction. Any normal reaction is to look at it and immediately throw it away and run right the fuck out the way. She holds it there for a good 10 seconds, screaming, and slowly putting it down to the ground, because a spider is a very delicate creature.
She did the slow...
A glass container.
Yeah, she did the slow head turn and eye bulge. Like, it was the hammiest, most unrealistic reaction. It's like, guys like Genghis, for instance, sorry about that, but, like, if they see spiders, if they see, like, tarantulas or whatever, it would just be a stimulus reaction.
Yeah, you would fucking bolt. You would see it and then you would run. It's not this long, drawn-out thing like it's a fucking horror movie where, you know, you're stuck there in utter and complete terror. And I'm sure that happens sometimes, but it's just...
Well, the way I kind of... I'll play devil's advocate here for a bit. Because that this is roughly just another form of theater in some ways, they have to over-exaggerate so people can see what's happening. You know, if you're, like, way up in the back and they're playing things rather normally, you may not be able to tell what's actually happening. So her doing a huge, over-exaggerated freakout, everyone knows, oh, whatever she's holding, I can't really see it, but it's scaring the crap out of her.
Actually,
I'm not saying this
you are right.
Silly. I'm not saying I wasn't entertained, but this was extremely silly. But
oh, and they pushed it even farther than necessary, but, you know.
It's definitely white wrestling.
Because once she puts the spider down, she slowly backs away. Like, if she runs, it's going to chase her or something. And she walks right into the middle, and Tara gets the win. And then following the match, Tara takes Poison out of the cage, and while carrying it, she chases Madison off. And we all get our feel-good moment of Madison running away like a bitch.
It's a cute spot.
Well, actually, this probably wasn't worth mentioning, but we skipped a part.
Did
we?
Yeah, Scott Steiner was backstage hitting on SoCal Val before this match, trying to get her to come back to his hotel room when he gets taken up by one of the Joker clones.
Yeah, basically being Scott Steiner, where, like, three out of every... five backstage promos he cuts has to involve him hitting on the interviewer if it's a woman, or yelling at the interviewer if it's a man.
But it's pretty much the exact same thing as what happened to him. It's so no use.
Yeah.
Backstage segment after Rayne and Tara's match with the British Invasion, they're like, you know what? Oh, okay, no accents. You know what? It was great that we got Rob Terry back.
Really?
Yes, that's no places.
The sentences that should never be uttered. It's so great that we got Rob Terry back.
It's like, you know how people were like, if Ultimate Warrior didn't have the look and the charisma, the physique, like, he'd pretty much have nothing. Rob Terry's Ultimate Warrior without the look, the charisma, and the physique. Boy, he's got the physique. And you could say he has the look, but it's bland.
Yeah.
I don't know.
He looks like when you turn all the sliders up in fucking SmackDown vs. Raw.
Yeah, pretty much.
Anyways, moving on from that, it's time for Kurt Angle, everyone.
Yay.
Because he announces that he's going to win the world title at Hardcore Justice. Yes, it's still being called that, but no, thank God it doesn't have anything to do with ECW anymore.
At least not as far as we know.
No.
I just had a horrifying fucking thought, didn't I?
But yeah, he goes on to say that whether Anderson wins or lose, he's going to hurt you. And he plans to watch this Sting match just as an innocent bystander. Nonetheless, Hardcore Justice, he's walking out with the championship.
Did it look like Kurt lost weight to anybody else?
The training he's doing for the Olympics.
It's probably Kurt. The deadbeat beard.
I guess this was an okay... Well, wait, no, because I just remembered... something incredibly fucking stupid that he said during this promo.
What did he say? Oh, yeah.
He said that people have come up to him and said the empty arena match that he had with Sting is one of the greatest matches of all time.
When did they even have an empty arena match?
It's like fucking 2 years ago when the fucking Main Event Mafia died. I don't fucking know. Oh, God.
Four words, guys. Four words. Melina and Alicia Fox.
It's like this. that was the greatest match of all time. It's not any of the matches Ricky Steamboat had with Ric Flair. It's not, you know, Bret Hart versus Shawn Michaels. It's not fucking Shawn.
It's not fucking Hercule versus Lance Storm.
It's not Hercules versus Ultimate Warrior. It's fucking Sting versus Kurt Angle in an empty arena.
10 years ago, maybe. Ten years ago, that would have been the best match ever. But it would have been really damn cool to see 10 years ago.
I guess. That hurt my.
And that's a lot. We seem to say that a lot about TNA. I'm starting to realize.
Oh yeah, so and so match would have been better 10, 12, 15 years ago. Oh yeah, when the majority of your main event were big stars that long ago, it has to come up.
Oh god, damn it! Here we go. Just moving on.
Moving on to fun-loving Jarrett. We have him and Carrot. Dice caller Carrot.
Works for me.
But yeah.
Actually, no, I like carrots.
Either way, Karen and Jeff are going to their car. They're like, we got to get out of here. Like, those clowns are beating everyone up. I sure hope we won't encounter them.
Oh, and for extra comedy, Jeff is carrying the suitcase with his belt in it, but Karen's got all the luggage. Wasn't that funny to see her struggling?
Oh, yeah. They jump into the SUV, and Karen is loading the bags into the back, and out jumps a Joker clone.
Karen just runs the fuck.
Oh, don't sound very surprised at that.
I thought it was funny.
What would have been funny is if he had been allowed to beat up Karen, too.
Oh, yeah, you hate her, don't you?
You have serious problems with that woman.
Yeah, we can't say that, but duos can.
Things happen to her, fake horrible things, but horrible things nonetheless.
Duos wants to play the torture game with Karen Angle.
Yeah, thank you. Took the words out of my mouth. We can hold a version of
You can actually put. You can take photos of people and photo and.
Oh
put
God, Duos, no.
Yeah,
no.
A light bulb
God
just
damn
went
it.
Off.
Gave her I think we just gave her an idea.
Nah, it's not worth the effort.
But anyway, we move on from that monumental event to Mexican America versus the British Invasion, where Mexican America basically. Hernandez spreads his arms and tells everyone his credo, nada es imposible.
By the way, what's wrong with Hernandez's voice exactly? Because they keep giving the mic to Chavo Bagwell. And I'd like to know why, because he sucks on the mic.
What's wrong with Hernandez's voice? Well, beyond the fact that he sounds like Eric Young and Brian Pillman run through a cancer grinder, I don't...
Yeah, I was going to say he sounds like an even raspier Vin Diesel.
You say Diesel?
I said Vin Diesel.
Yeah. Oh, Vin.
You know.
Yeah. Anyways, the whole point of this match is that the British Invasion wants a fair one-on-one fight, and they begin this fight by ambushing Mexican America, running to the ring, immediately when their entrance music starts playing, and just jumping them.
Didn't they say they wanted a fair fight?
Yes, that's the point.
Yeah. Maybe they should have specified, we just don't want your little girlfriends to show up.
We're going to cheat all we want, but these little hoochies, they got to stay in back.
Yeah, this match was really forgettable. Like, it also kind of pissed me off, because one of the things that Magnus did, he did one of the most nonchalant, like, Michinoku drivers, and, like, you don't fucking do that spot nonchalantly.
Yeah, you don't you don't pick a guy up and almost drop him on their head like it's not.
It's the equivalent of a Kevin Nash powerbomb almost.
Yeah.
Well,
I'm just gonna pick you up and then I'm gonna drop you and I hope you protect yourself.
But And oh yeah, and also Douglas Williams' European uppercut sucks. It's awful.
William Regal would be ashamed of you, Douglas Williams.
Yeah, Castagnoli, Dory Funk.
Yeah.
Everyone who could, Danielson. God damn.
I'm having flashbacks to the Royal Rumble of Daniel Bryan versus William Regal.
Uppercut.
No, stop that. I did that enough when I was there.
Awesome.
Anyways, the finish comes when it looks like Williams is about to get the pin, but then Sarita and Rosita run out to the ring.
It was just Rosita.
Yeah, it was just Rosita because Sarita has actually contracted. Is it Bell's palsy or is it just facial paralysis?
Wait, really?
Oh. Yeah, were you not here when we were talking about that, No Leaf?
I have not heard of this.
The left side of her face has become paralyzed, unfortunately.
Oh.
She's going to continue to wrestle wearing a luchador mask, though, while she receives treatment for this.
Iron Bite saying in the chat that it was an injury.
It was an injury she sustained, so it's not Bell's palsy. It's just an injury. She apparently needs surgery, and she's going to continue to wrestle hurt because she works for TNA, and they're not going to fucking pay for this.
If you ever listen to this, Sarita, if you're out there somewhere, we wish you a speedy recovery.
But anyways, based on the distraction, Mexican America gets the win. So we're going to be seeing Beer Money versus Mexican America pretty soon, and the wrestling world collectively sighs in apathy.
Yeah. Well, at least Beer Money is in it.
Oh no, like, we were talking, the reason why I said that the British invasion, like, didn't they say they wanted a fair fight? That's what Mike Tenay said. He was like, all the Brits wanted was a fair fight!
and you fucked it up!
Considering he's the dopey face, that just sounded really stupid. Wait, that sentence was really redundant.
Oh, well. Department of Redundancy Department.
Anyways, we go back to Eric Bischoff, and Gunner and Bully Ray are the only two left in Immortal that have not had the crap kicked out of them by the Joker clones. And Bischoff says he wants this taken care of, and Gunner, he starts talking to Bully Ray. He's like, you know what, screw this, man, we're going to go out there and we're going to find them. They can't take both of us at the same time. And Bully Ray's like, yeah, we're going to do this. And they start leaving. And as soon as Gunner's out of frame, Bully Ray just comes back and like, okay, I'm going to chill out here. You go have fun. And yeah. After a package hyping up the X Division title match for next week, sure enough, free Gunner TV. Is in the parking lot. I'm sorry, did you want to say something?
No, free TV. That's all I got to say.
Yeah, free TV. Gunner's in the parking lot, and he gets surrounded by four Joker clones and, of course, gets his ass kicked.
Well, yeah, I want to talk about this first because Gunner...
Yes, go ahead.
Because they portray Gunner as, like, the fucking big, tough guy who's going to take on four bat-wielding guys all by himself. And I think
working for the crazy man.
Yeah. I think we're supposed to think...
I'm crazy! I tried to eat the television title, for God's sakes!
Not even that he's crazy, that, like, he's the big, tough guy. And, like, you're going into a fucking battle 4-on-1. That's not tough. And even if it was tough, it's fucking stupid. You fail, TNA. You fail, Mr. Bischoff, at pushing this ass clown. Oh, yeah. And fuck you, Gunner. Fuck you hard.
Yeah, and oh, yeah. Oh. God bless.
Yeah. Anyways, they beat down Gunner, and then they take off their masks, and it pans up to reveal that it is Fortune. Two questions. One, why is Fortune helping Sting? Two, why does Fortune still exist?
Well, it's. I mean, that could easily be written off as like, okay, your fight is my fight. They tried to take out the X Division. They're trying to disenfranchise you, even though you're going crazy and you probably can't be trusted. So we'll help you.
But it makes no sense. We haven't seen Fortune as a cohesive unit in 3 months since lockdown.
Yeah, I really can't defend it on that front. But to talk about funny things, the when they were still like masked, the clown mask, they came in like tapping the bats to the concrete floor. See, the way I heard it, I thought that they were snapping, so it was like they were going for like a West Side Story style-y of introduction. But speaking of looking staged, that like Gunner took him on basically by taking him one on one. Like what?
It was like the reverse thing in a. It was like the reverse of every martial arts movie.
Yeah, where one person is like dodging like different. I mean, it's not like they could choreograph something like that, but still, it looked staged. And that's not what TNA's going for with their always shooting ethic. But if we move on to our main event, oh my god. I mean, this isn't Victory Road, but fuck. Like, this is awesome. It's notable for fucking anything. It was just that seeing Sting do the fucking mic check on Anderson, it looked even smoother than Anderson's version.
I think mentioning Anderson trying to do what that was, the Scorpion Deathlock. That looked so bad, I could tell.
God.
And I can't tell shit.
Well, Anderson did do a good mic check. I mean, not Anderson, Sting.
Sting, yes.
That's fine, and, you know, that's all well and good, but Anderson, it did not look like in any way effective.
Yeah, it didn't look a good figure four. Like, the
if
legs
I
were
tell
just...
you're doing it wrong, you're really fucking up.
Like, there was a huge gap between the legs. They didn't look locked at all. Oh, my God, your sharpshooter is worse than the rocks. You get that fucking dishonor.
Oh, that's horrible. That's horrible.
Oh, this match was horrible.
Yeah.
For all the buildup of this Midsummer Nightmare match.
Oh, yeah, that was the other thing, because I had to watch TNA again today. I had to kind of refresh my memory on some things. And I actually missed the whole Midsummer Nightmare thing, and I'd forgotten about it, too. So on my second viewing, it came, you know, Sting's talking about it, the whole Midsummer Nightmare. I'm like, this is what they meant?
What was nightmarish about it? It was just a fucking match.
Well,
the match itself was pretty nightmarish, but...
The match will give the nightmares for fun.
But because of its mediocrity. But
anyways, let's just get to the finish if nobody else has anything to say. What happens is ref takes a bump. Sting gets Anderson into the Scorpion Deathlock, which only looks slightly better than Ken Anderson's version of it. And Anderson taps out, but there's no ref, so of course Bully Ray, the last man standing in Immortal, decides to come down and he's like, "I'm gonna fuck you up, Sting." And he takes out that stupid chain he's wearing off his tux. By the way, why was he still wearing the tux?
That was interesting. They didn't even really loosen anything throughout the night. They're perfectly.
Oh, hi, Bully.
Except Hogan took off his coat.
God.
You saw no hanging bow tie. There was no, at least no hanging bow tie. I mean, Dolph Ziggler had that on Raw, and like he didn't even go through anything.
Anyways, they beat down Sting, and then the lights go out again, and then they come back up. One of Fortune is in the ring, masked again, like it matters anymore, and they've beaten down Bully Ray. Lights go out again. They come back. Anderson is alone in the ring. Sting comes up behind him, hits him with the Scorpion Death Drop. Ref conveniently decides to jump back in the ring at that moment. 1, 2, 3. Sting is your new World Heavyweight Champion again.
On TV.
I have no words. I have nothing to say to that.
Actually, the last clown was Kurt Angle, as it turns out. What a surprise. Yeah. I didn't see that coming.
Oh, God. Impact.
Yeah.
Why can't you just be good?
People say the WWE title is meaningless because it gets bounced around so often.
And often goes back to Cena, however you guys feel about that. But
What?
At least changed his hands on pay-per-views.
Yeah, you're right about that.
Russo!
Goodness.
God. It looks like he's broken again.
Oh, I'm gonna kill you, you fucking mosquito. I'm gonna fucking kill you. No. Sorry, I'm worrying about other things.
Yeah. We noticed.
I just don't know. I just want the show to be good. That's so fucking bad. It's again. I just want to say this real quick. In the past couple weeks, I have watched the show with my girlfriend and with a friend of mine who is deaf. I am still not sure which person it was more hard to explain half the shit that happens on this show to. I just want it to make sense so I can be able to watch it. But not only, if I've been watching wrestling for 10 years and I can't follow half the shit that's happening and I think it sucks, how the hell is anyone else supposed to like it or get into it?
Search me.
The only thing that gives me comfort is the fact that I think TNA is doing this on purpose now. They know that this gets them attention when they do crap like this. And they're just banking on the fact that they'll piss us off so much and we'll just keep watching it because we can't believe what we're seeing on TV is actually happening.
And I'm going to mention this again tomorrow when we talk about WWE, but TNA, if they get Johnny Curtis to trend worldwide, oh boy, that fucking F game, oh.
God.
I've had enough of this. Yeah. What do you say we take it home with what gets more screen time than Jay Lethal?
Lego.
I want to start. Poison the Spider gets more screen time than Jay Lethal. It's a cute little tarantula.
Anderson's hideous tuxedo gets more screen time than Jay Lethal.
Jarrett's sombreros and margaritas get more screen time than Jay Lethal. No, but he served them drinks, didn't he?
Oh, I don't know. Jarrett was involved. I was trying not to pay too close attention, lest my brain rot.
Oh, God. What got more screen time than Jay Lethal this week? Do headaches count?
Yeah, try a little harder.
What got more screen time than Jay Lethal? Madison Rayne's new moveset called I Stumble Around got more screen time than Jay Lethal.
You know what? My ass got more screen time than Jay Lethal.
My girlfriend got more screen time than Jay Lethal.
This has been the Dark Match. I hate every single one of you. I'm Backlash.
Don't say you hate them!
I don't think it's talking
YouTube has been instructing me to put Jeff Hardy tags in every single video I put up.
I'm Christopher tested on its own. Backlash, don't hate the player, hate the game.
I'm your token chick, Duo's Angel.
And I'm no leaf clover. Until next time, folks, good night and good luck.
I'm just a warm music.
God, you guys. You guys.
Guys, you're not going to believe this. After I forgot I had my window open, after I screamed Russo, my neighbor called me up to complain. That's my answering machine went off.